So I wanted to say something about my sense of the nature of the majority. And I do believe that roughly or approximately, these really are the people that Nietzsche called the herd. I never really knew that they existed. I never really understood what was plainly around me, in front of me, and in every direction. And I believe this might be because I was actually so stressed, so traumatized by one event after the other, subsequent to the migration experience I had in 1984. It was a hard, hard experience. Very arid at first, very alienating, very lacking in nourishment and meaning and purpose. And of course, my immune system immediately felt it, and I had various viruses from that point on. And I don't know. It was chalk and cheese, as the expression goes, back in Zimbabwe, or what was called Rhodesia. I was a very robust kid, and I still am. I'm still that robust kid, but I've faced a lot of onslaughts of a lot of negativity. And to me, the blandness of the everyday existence that the majority embrace is a strong negativity. It's a strong repulsive force for me that actually seems to be, in a way, like the fog in Dante's Inferno. It's trying to wield its way under my skin and get to me. This is something that I contend with. I dislike modernity. I dislike it. But if I'm on the trace of an odor, if I'm on the hunt, I can be fully at one with myself. I can be fully integrated with the experience, and it's a vitalizing experience for me. It's a very boosting of my immune system, of my well-being, and everything, because I'm using all my energies and bringing them all together for one goal, for one purpose. My art work has a shamanic theme, and shamanism, in the traditional sense, is the idea, the religion of hunters and gatherers. But yeah, I found out about modern psychology that the herd actually exists. And I had thought Nietzsche was just being disparaging about some others, some kind of sense of an abstract identity of other being. And I never grasped that. No, there is a herd. There is actually the majority, and they do make up the herd. And this is what has been actually a very belated revelation for me, that most people are behaving normally according to the herd ideology. They are behaving at their flattened state of existence. Their static nature is considered normal. I, however, am considered abnormal. What a revelation that is. I had assumed it would be the opposite, but now I know. Now I know that now that the sea of the herd surrounds me on the internet, and everybody, the majority, are drowning out my voice with theirs, and their voice is considered to be righteous and correct, I know that I'm the one. I'm the unusual one. I'm the different one. And they would even like to pathologize me. They would. They would too, on the basis that I'm not like them. They would too. And there is a tendency in contemporary psychology to do that as well, because they set up a paradigm whereby anything outside, anything that colors outside of the lines, is pathological. basically meaning it's not understood, and therefore feared, and therefore disliked, and therefore labeled. But actually, basically, uncomprehended by any means. So finding out that that the herd was a thing, the herd is an actual material, physical, substantial beast, an entity, that was amazing. I found it out through the process of trying to get some therapy for my state of being. Actually, I was trying to get some moral support for my state of being during an extreme situation with menopausal hormonal swings back and forth, up and down, in a way that really ricocheted my physiology. It's like supposing you had a very delicate machine, any kind of machine, if you can imagine it, a scientific machine or something, and somebody fiddles with the knobs and they push it to the temperature really high, then drop it very low, then very high, and something like that. That machine is going to be very very badly affected by those alterations of the knobs, and those knobs were being altered inside of me against my will. I had no control. Such a bad situation. Anyway, that's why I tried to seek therapy. But what I found from therapy is that therapy is designed toward the herd, or the herd type of person, and that when I try to relate my story, the story is not considered relevant, because why is the story relevant? Its story is a narrative. A narrative is useful for those who are going on a hunt. It can inform about the lay of the land. It can inform about previous experiences. It can inform about possible dangers and possible benefits of the environment. But if you're not on a hunt, if you're simply static and rooted to the ground, the narrative isn't relevant. It's not relevant to you. You don't need it. In fact, any kind of insistence on a narrative would probably lead people to think it was a pathology to focus so much on something that has occurred or would occur, anything like that. So I found that the mentality that most people have and what they most expect is devoid of narrative, but much more focused on stabilizing a much more narrow state of existence than I have. Anyway, it was a very bizarre finding for me to find, Nietzsche, when he mentioned that there's a herd, that the herd has a morality, wow, he actually meant it very, very literally. That was weird. That was really weird.